everybody pray for him.
Your niece's husband fell and broke his leg?
I don't know if anybody knows him, was in Newcastle.
Okay, just remember this. Okay. Anyone else?
I'd still like to remember my sister's great grandson, Luke. He's still gonna have to go back to St. Jude's.
Okay.
Have some more things done. His leukemia is back. He's just 3 years old.
How old?
Three.
3 years old and leukemia's back. Wow, bless his heart. Okay, all right. What was the relation again?
It's my sister's great-grandson.
Your sister's great-grandson. Okay, remember this. Be going to Jude Hospital. Okay, remember this. Anyone else?
Keep Doug West in prayer. I saw a Facebook post where he was doing the immunotherapy and he's having some issues with it too.
Who was that now?
Doug West.
Okay, so he's doing immunotherapy? Yeah, okay. Well, I hope it works for him. It does. It didn't work for Barbara, but I talked to my cousin. I preached a funeral last Sunday evening at Rockford Baptist. One of my cousins, he had cancer 10 years ago, and he told me, he said, you need to get Barbara to go take that Opdivo. I said, she done took Opdivo. It didn't work for her. And he said the doctor told him that 1 out of 13 it works for. That's not really good odds, I don't guess, 1 out of 13. But anyway, it didn't work for Barbara. So I hope it works for Doug. I do. So I hope it does. Anyone else? Barbara's not doing well today at all. She's just one of those days. She's just so sick and so weak. Blood pressure bottoming out again, so. Feet swollen up so bad. She'll be going to Dr. Friday, and I don't think she's told the doctor about that, but I will. I'll tell him. I don't know whether that'll help or not, but I'll tell him. Debbie, you going to have the MRI Friday? Okay, remember Debbie. She'll have that Friday. So we got a lot of things going on, and let's pray for these people and all the other requests. Anyone else before we pray? Okay, pray for Earl.
I've got a scan tomorrow on my main artery where it forks below my heart.
Mm-hmm.
They say I've got an aneurysm under and they have to put me a plastic tube in there.
Oh, really?
Okay.
Okay. Well, we'll sure remember that in prayer. Remember Earl, this artery there. Yeah. Okay. Anyone else? Okay, Father, we approach you with reverence and respect. You are the only true living God. There are other gods that men and women worship. Man has always been religious. Humanity will always worship something. But I'm so glad that we've come to your house here this morning to worship you. And we are to worship you in spirit and in truth. And I pray we do that this morning. We pray for the music, God, that songs that will be sung. Earl and the musicians here who play these instruments. And Earl, as he leads us and as we sing, may it come from our hearts. And God, we thank you, Father, for the opportunity to worship you this morning. We'll also bring these petitions before you. You know, Father, I have to write them down. You don't. You remember them. And you know the needs of these people. And you can do something about them. Whatever your will is, God, so may it be. Sometimes it's hard for me to pray that prayer. Not my will, but your will. We all find it hard to pray sometimes. But God, we must. We must. And I pray for your will to be done, God. Not only in these people's lives, but in my life likewise. I had a long text today from a friend of mine whose husband is really going through very difficult times. And Father, I prayed, and I pray for Ann and Clyde here this morning because of what they're going through. And other people, got so many other people, Lord. And Father, I just pray for Lois Andes. Brother Ralph, I talked to Ralph on, I think it was a few weeks ago, he got, I addressed him here on Facebook, and Brother Ralph died. He was buried yesterday, but thank you, Lord, for saving Brother Ralph before he stepped into eternity. Thank you for that. And I pray for Lois, and I know she's watching now. Just pray for Lois that you be with her. And Father, there's people dying, there's people sick, and you know all about them, and there's so many people, God, that I have on my heart, and God, in different parts of the country, different states, and I pray for all them. And just pray for this service, God. I pray for our country. God, we're in a crisis. We need help. God, I'd like to hear from heaven. God, next Saturday, we're going to come and pray here. And I hope, God, young people, middle-aged people, older people, just come out and say, let's pray. That's the solution to our problems. We got a crisis, God. And Lord, I pray, Father, for you to help us. Guide us into all truth and righteousness. We give you glory and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus died on the cross that we could have this privilege that we have here today. And we're certainly thankful for each one that's come. All over this country, there's people gathered to worship God. And we want to do that today. And let's turn to 305, the old rugged cross. First, second, last verse. The old rugged cross.
Praise the Lord.
All right. Thank you. Mr. Murrell.
Amen. Yes, thank you, Jesus.
I appreciate your prayers as I sing this. It's been over 25 years since I sang this, so I have practiced since then. But I would like to dedicate it to Miss Reba Breeden, my Sunday school teacher, that's had a knee replacement, and she's at home watching. Save wait to join us in thy praise forevermore.
Oh, yes. Amen, Murray.
Everybody gets to sing now. You'll stand again. We'll sing, "We've come into this house, gathered in his name to worship."
Mm-hmm.
Worship
Christ the Lord.
Everybody sing now. We have come into this house. Lift up holy hands, magnify his name, and worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord.
Let's give him a hand. Amen. Beautiful, beautiful singing. Thank you.
All right, we're in the third sermon on a date with death. We're going to finish this up today, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 24 through 28. Now, when you look at chapter 9, it talks about Christ's sacrifice is superior to the high priest's sacrifice, correct? And all the high priest had was an animal. He is the sacrifice, superior. And then there is the promise of the new covenant in the beginning of this chapter. But I'm going to pick it up in chapter and review just a little before we get into it as a way of an introduction to the last part. The first sermon was the appearance of Christ after his ascension, and that is verse 24 through 26. So let's, and I added a little something to that as I studied that. So we've done talked about it, but we haven't talked about this. This is, I didn't talk about this last week. So this ascension, his appearance, I'm sorry, after his ascension, the purpose that he set at the Father's right hand is Hebrews chapter 1, verse number 3. It says, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power. Do you believe that? That he puts all of this in action, and the sun, the moon, the stars, and the planets and that rotate. He's got it all under his power, under his spoken power. When he by himself, this is the verse right here. When he had by himself purged whose sins? Our sins. The world's sins. Purged our sins. What did he do? He sat down. It's finished. I've done what I came to do. I purged, cleansed the sins of humanity. And he sits down at the right hand of the Father, of the Majesty on high. So our sins have been cleansed. I'm clean this morning. I stand here before you, a recipient of God's divine grace, because he purged my sin. For that sin would have ultimately taken me to hell. And that sin would have ultimately taken you to hell. But Jesus said, I'll take care of it. And he did. And he purged my sin. So that's what happened at that appearance when he went back. Now, Psalms chapter 51, verse 2. This is the prayer of David. David said, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. So I was lost. He cleansed me from my sin. I've been saved and I still needed cleansing, right? David was a man after God's own heart. And he sinned against God, and yet he's praying, Father, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. So I not only needed him for salvation, I need him today as I go along this journey toward heaven. Because we do mess up. We do sin. And he is our great adversary. And he is our great, I'm sorry, advocator. And he sits at the Father's right hand making intercessions for us. So thank God for that. Purged our sins. Now, but there's another thing he did. And Christ was our propitiation for our sin. And you can find that John chapter 2, verse number 2. Listen to what it says. And he, that's Christ, is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole wide world out there. 6 billion people on this planet. I don't know, very few of them are saved, but he is the propitiation for all of their sins. That means he is the appeaser. He is the satisfier. Who had to be satisfied? Who had to be appeased? God did. God had to be satisfied. God had to be appeased, and Christ pleased him because of what he did on the cross. So when God looked down and saw his son being there on the cross, bleeding and dying, he was pleased to the fact that whosoever will, when they confess him as Lord and Savior, they too can be saved. So God was pleased with his son by his obedience to the cross. So those are the two things that happened. Now, there is the appointment with God after death. I talked about that last week. As it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment. Well, I got a couple things I want to say about that I didn't say last week. The spiritual death of the saints in Matthew chapter 6, verse 2. There's two deaths, ladies and gentlemen, that you're going to face. And I'm going to face. First of all, the very moment that I became aware of my lostness, the very moment I became aware of that, then I was living in sin. The world was in me. The world controlled my spirit. I was lost in sin. And now I was dead as far as God's concerned, right? As far as God was concerned, I was dead. I was not alive. And so, God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin? But it's different now. When you get saved, you were dead. I mean, before you got saved, you were dead in sin. To God, God looked at you and said, you're dead, spiritually dead. Now, God forbid, how shall we, Paul says here, how shall we that are dead to sin? I'm not dead in it no more. I'm dead to it. So you see, now I have experienced what kind of a death? A spiritual death. Now this spiritual death is I've died to the world. I'm dead to the world. I'm unresponsive to the world. And you are dead to the world. You're unresponsive to it. And the devil has no more power over me. See, and over you. Thank God for that. So this spiritual death of the saints. And by the way, you say, well, I ain't a saint. Well, what are you? If you're not a saint, what are you? You see, well, all the Catholicism teaches us that the Pope has to do it. Oh, he ain't got no business doing that. He can't do that. The Pope, you say, well, you got to accomplish certain things in life before you can be a saint. Nice. That's what they believe. Well, the very moment you got saved, I want to tell you, you are a saint. Now, we don't always act like it, do we? I've not always acted like a saint. But it doesn't matter whether I act like it or not, I am. We get the word sanctified. That's what the word comes from. It comes from sanctified. It means set apart. We are set apart for God's children, and it's saint. That's what the word uses. We use the word saint. So we are saints, and we're set apart for God's work. Now, but there is the spirit. I'm dead to the world. The world has no appeal to me. Now, the devil tries to tempt me, and he does that day after day after day, seems like hour after hour, trying to pull me away from God. He hates God, and he knows that God loves me, and if he can pull me away from God or you away from God, then he's done his job. And he's good at it. He's good at it. But I always remind them of this. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. He don't have near the power God has. God has way more power. That's spiritual death. So the spiritual death of the saints determines what judgment you will stand in. Right? The spiritual death of a saint determines which good judgment you'll stand in. Which one will it be? It won't be the white throne judgment, will it? No, it'll be the judgment of Christ. If you're a saint, you've been born again, talked about that last week, this death, this spiritual death, that I died to the world, then I will appear at the judgment seat of Christ, give an account of the deeds done in the body, whether they be good or whether they be bad. Now, I don't have the answers to all that, but I do know that it's going to happen. All I know is that I'm going to show up and you're going to show up. But that's far better than showing up at the great white throne judgment. Because you know who's going to show up there? It ain't going to be me. But let's look at this before I get to that. Verse number 6. Knowing this, aware of this, I'm aware of this, that our old man is crucified with him. This old nature. See, I'm born with this nature. Everybody's born with a sinful nature. Everybody's got that. And so this old man is crucified. So my old nature was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed. That body of sin that's in that old nature might be destroyed. Wait a minute, it's not destroyed. I still can do the same things I used to do. And the devil tempts me to do those things. The devil wants me to do those things. So it's not really destroyed, but you got to understand the word. The word destroyed means to annihilate and do away with. Okay, but that's an English word coming from the Greek text. And that's the way the translators did it back in when they translated the Bible into the King James. But it doesn't mean destroyed. It means to render inoperative in your life. It means that this old nature, this body of sin, is rendered inoperative. It doesn't. Who the black comedian Flip Wilson said, the devil made me do it, right? Well, he can't make you do it. He would like to get you to do it, and he'll do everything in his power to get you to do it, but he can't make you do it. See? Because, you see, this is rendered inoperative. This body of sin is rendered inoperative in me. I would rather read the Bible. I would rather pray. I would rather come to church, and that's what keeps this old man under control, right? This old nature has to be under control. By the way, ladies and gentlemen, you still have the potentiality of doing a lot of bad things. You know that? I have the potentiality of doing a lot of bad things. And I can do them. Don't want to do them. And sometimes I mess up and don't want, but we all mess up and we have to pray and ask God forgiveness. But he does forgive. So that happens. So the old man is crucified with him. The body of sin might be destroyed. That henceforth we should what? Not serve sin. Now, if you really and truly come to this altar, pray the sinner's prayer, ask Christ to come into your heart, stand up and say, I confess Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, you're not going to go back out there in the world. If you really got saved, if you really got born again, you're not going to go back out in the world and live like the sinners do. Right? I believe there's a difference, aren't there? I was a changed person. I'm playing baseball, and I said, dear God, can I play baseball? Oh, yeah, go ahead. I just quit going to the places I used to go with these guys. But it didn't affect my ball playing. I hope it helped it. You know, I'm a Christian now. But anyway, you see, I have the potential, and you have the potential, and what bothers me might not bother you. What tempts me might not tempt you. But let me tell you, you've got them, and I've got them, and the devil will do everything in his power to pull us away to serve him. He wants to be worshipped, and the world is worshiping Satan. The god of this world is Satan, and they're worshiping him. The old man is crucified. For he that is dead is what? I'm free from sin. It's not predominant. It's not controlling my life. I'm free from that. Thank God for that. Spiritual death of the saints. Now let's move on to the second death of the saints, sinners. This is the second death. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5. Even when we were dead in sins, we were at one time, we've all been sinners, has quickened. What does that word quickened mean? Made alive. Come back alive. So therefore it speaks of a spiritual resurrection, correct? There is a spiritual resurrection. Quickened us together with Christ. And it's what? By grace. By grace you're saved. By grace. By God's unmerited favor. God did us a favor. We owe him this morning, right? What do we owe him? All he asks is worship. Why can't God's people get that? Why can't church members get that? Just one day a week could come to God's house and worship him who died for you and who died for me? Why don't they get that? We owe him a life of committedness. Give him your life. It's by grace. He did a favor. You know, I would die for my children, and I'm sure you would too. Wouldn't mean a thing. Jesus died for all people. It's by grace that we're saved. Second death. You die once physically, but the sinner's going to die the second death. Is that a dangerous death to die? Look at Revelation 20:14. And death and hell were cast into what? Is that the second death? So, if you die a sinner, if you die lost, never accepting Christ as your Lord and your Savior, never in any way say, I accept Christ as my Lord and Savior, and you die, where are you going? That is the second death, physical death. So, you go back to what I said a moment ago about, you know, your Savior determines your judgment. Your salvation determines your judgment. If you're saved, you go to the Bema judgment. If you're lost, you go to the white throne judgment. And that's where the sinners show up at. They show up at the white throne judgment and death and hell. So hell is, could I say that hell is really not eternal? Oh, you say it is. No, it's not. It's not. Look at that verse. Look at the verse. Look at the words. See, you got to look at the words. You got to understand the word. Here it says, and death and hell were what? If people die today, lost, where they go? To hell. It's probably in the heart of the earth. They go there. There's fire there. They're punished there. We know that because of Luke 16. Okay? But hell is not eternal. Hell will be cast into the lake of fire. Death and hell will be delivered up. The books will be opened. And you read that in Revelation chapter 20. And the small and great lost sinners will be judged from the books. And their names and whatever they've done in life, there will be judged for those things. But there's going to be one book. Your name had better be in the Lamb's Book of Life. That is the book of life, and that is the Lamb's Book of Life. And if your name is not in the Lamb's Book of Life, you will be cast into the lake of fire, and that's the second death. And that's where sinners go. Have you ever heard, I remember growing up, these kids, these boys would make a reference to them, you know. I've heard some of them boys around say, well, I'm just going to go to hell with the rest of my friends. All my friends are going down. I'm just going to go down there and have a party. That's a stupid statement, ain't it? What party? There's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Ain't going to be no party. And yet they say, I'm just going to go with them. I really have known of people saying, well, my dad died lost. I just want to go where he goes. I've had that to happen. Some of my loved ones, I know where they're at. They've gone to hell. I just want to go too, right? That's what they do. And they die. Boy, how pitiful that is. But it happens. It happens. Death and hell will be cast into the lake of fire. The second death of the sinners. Now, the appearance of Christ the second time. First time, sat down at the Father's right hand. There to appear after the ascension to make intercessions for us. And he became the great high priest. He sat down for that purpose. Earned it. Talked about that last week. But the appearance of Christ the second time during the rapture of the church, Hebrews 9:28. So. For this reason, you could use that word so, for this reason Christ was once offered. For what reason? Well, verse 27, for he's appointed a man wants to die, and after this the judgment. For that reason. For the reason of death, for the reason of judgment, Christ was once what? Offered. Presented, just as the sacrifice was presented. So Christ was once offered to bear, to carry the sins of many. Now, in the book of Numbers, I believe it is, Leviticus, I can't remember what chapter, but you can look up, just look up the word scapegoat. Just look up the word scapegoat if you want to understand what this means. Bear our sins. Two goats. High priest had two goats. The one goat was sacrificed. The blood was paid on the altar. The other goat, Aaron the high priest, went out and laid his head on that goat and prayed and all this of the sins of the nation of Israel. And then when he put his hands on that goat and prayed for all the sins of Israel, he turned the goat loose and sent it into the wilderness. And the goat carried the sins away. That's the picture here, ladies and gentlemen. Christ carried, bore our sins, carried our sins away, and he cast them into the sea of forgetfulness, never to be remembered against us anymore. Amen? He cast them away. Cora Ten Boone said it real well, and I love her book, the book she wrote. And she said, you know what? She said, yeah, God cast all of his sin, my sins in the sea of forgetfulness. And you know what else he did? She said he put up a no fishing sign. You can't bring them up anymore. Thank God, isn't that wonderful? And I can't forget, and you can't forget, but God forgets them. God forgets them. Took them, bore our sins, of many. Why didn't he say bore the sins of all? Because all's not going to believe him. So he bore the sins of many. That was interesting to me. Bore the sins of many. Well, let me give you a verse, Matthew chapter 22. If you go to chapter 22, you'll find there was a king there that gave a parable of a king about the kingdom. And he's going to marriage for his son. His son was getting married. And he was looking for a bride for his son, no doubt. So he sent all the people out to invite people to come to the marriage. And some of them said, no, I ain't going to go. Not going to go. But the last verse, I believe it is chapter 22, verse 14, said, many are called. Many are called. Many are invited. But few are chosen. So you see, he bore the sins of many. Aren't you glad you're one of those few, many right there? Aren't you glad he bore your sins? Aren't you glad he carried your sins and took your sins away? And took them away. Thank God, and we're here this morning. Recipients of God's glorious grace, we've come to worship the King. Many are called. Many are invited. I'll never, as long as I live, forget the time God called me into the kingdom. It was a call. It was a spiritual awakening in my life that I knew nothing about. I'd heard preachers preach most of my life. I was a young boy when Dad got right with God and took me to church, and I'd heard preachers preach and all that. But boy, there was something took place when the Holy Spirit shined light down into my spirit and showed me my lostness, and I was lost without hope. Boy, I'll never forget that day. I will never. And when the devil can run me back that far, but when he gets that far, he can't take me no further. I said, wait a minute, Satan. The God of heaven showed me that there's a hell to shun and a heaven to gain. And I accept Christ as my Lord and my Savior. Glory to God. That'll make me shout hallelujah right now. I don't care how long you've been saved. Don't make no difference to me. If you've been saved today or two or three days or 50 years, it'll make you shout hallelujah. Look what the Lord done. Look what the Lord did in your life. He saved you. He called you. He invited you. He invited you into His kingdom. He invited you to be His son. He invited you to be His daughter. Don't take that lightly. Thank God for that call. Many are called. I was chosen. Why? Why did He choose me? And why did He choose you? He looked into your heart and saw your heart and knew you meant business. Does everybody that comes to the altar and makes a profession of faith and joins a church, are they all saved? Oh, no. They're not all saved. You can make a profession in this altar, and you can go out those doors and live, for Lord a while. But I think it lasts a pretty good while. I'm not saying you don't get out of kelter with God. I'm not saying that you can't backslide. You can. I believe that. But I still think if you've ever really been saved, you'll come back one way or the other. God can get your attention. I've seen Him get some people's attention. He knows how to get our attention. And so He was offered to bear the sins of many. And unto them that were saved. You could go back to that many. And unto them that many that look for Him. Are you really looking for the Lord? To cast your eyes. I'm looking for Him. I looked for Him to come yesterday. As a matter of fact, I'm going to look for Him to come today. I am. Spiritually. I don't just stand outside my house and some look up to the sky and say, what are you looking at? They say, Charles gone crazy. No, I don't do that. But I do look for, every morning when I go out, I look up at the sky. I say, boy, it's a beautiful sky. You know what I've learned to say? I've quit this griping and complaining. I used to gripe and complain if it's raining. I used to gripe and complain if it's snowing. I used to gripe and complain if it was below 32 degrees. I used to gripe all of that stuff. And God said, wait a minute. I made this day. This is a day I've made. Rejoice and be glad in it. If you need to stay in the house and put a pair of gloves on or boots on and two or three coats on. Don't complain. I quit complaining. Every day I say, dear God, I thank you for the day you made it, and it's a day you've made that I want to rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. I just want to praise the Lord. God just started grippers. We got too many griping Baptists anyway, ain't we? Bless God, they gripe over the toilet paper. If you get the wrong color toilet paper in the church, they gripe over it, you know, this and that and all that. So we preachers gripe too. We're about as bad as anybody. Let's get all of us. God wants us to be praisers, to praise the Lord. Lift your voice and praise. Lift your hands and praise to Him. One of these days when we get to glory, you're going to be in a... You're talking about being a service up there. Ooh, what a service that's going to be. Man, I heard one of the greatest evangelists preach, and I think it was Raleigh one time. I was out there at the pastor's conference, North Carolina Baptist Pastor's Conference, and a preacher Dunn. Can't think of his first name, but Dunn. He was Ron Dunn. Boy, he was a great preacher. Oh, Ron, boy, he got with us, and he said, you know, he said... Here's what's going to happen. Here's what's going to happen to us Baptists. We're kind of dignified, he said. We're dignified people, you know. We're Baptists real dignified. We don't like the charismatic people. We're more dignified. And he said, you know, I just can imagine when we get to heaven and we look and see all those people and all those angels and all of that throne and Jesus sitting on the throne and God sitting on the throne. He said, and some of us Baptists will walk in there and say, well, it sure is good to be here. It'll be more than that. It'll be more than it's good to be here. You might just lift your hands and praise the Lord. I don't know what you might do. I don't know, and I don't know what I'll do. But I'll tell you one thing. It'll be a great moment in my life when I get in where God's at. When I get to the Lord's house. Because I'm planning on living the Lord, aren't you? I'm going to live in the Lord's house. Someday, going to live in the Lord's house. All right, look for Him. Shall He what? Appear. I'm looking for Him to appear. And that might be collectively, that means all of us. All of us could go together. And by the way, Sonny said, you know, wait a minute, preacher, you said everybody's going to die. Well, Sonny was right. Not everybody's going to die. Do you know the people in the rapture won't die? They'll be changed. They'll be changed. But they won't die. People have already been dead for years. These will be changed in a moment, twinkling eye. 1 Corinthians 15. It's all there. So some won't die. Wouldn't you like to? I never will forget this. Let me say this to you. My homiletics professor, Dr. Kenneth Ryans, one of the greatest preachers I've ever met, he said this, and I've said it to you before, but a lot of you haven't heard it. I never will forget in class one day, we were having a class, and he looked, said, hey, fellas, said, you ever think about this? And somehow that Thessalonian chapter came up about, you know, Corinthians, I'm sorry, you know, some, and Thessalonians, both of them, those chapters said, you know, he said, I've often thought about dying and being buried about 6 foot. Ain't that what they do, about 6 foot? I guess. I don't have far to put us in the ground. 6, 8, 10, I don't know. It don't make any difference. You put 20 foot down there to still resurrect. Don't matter. But anyway, he said, I've often thought about that and that dirt on top of me and everything. And said, then I've often thought about the rapture. He said, I've often thought about that. Said, which would you rather do? Would you rather be dead and then resurrect from that grave? Or would you rather be changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye? Well, I think I might have said, well, brother, I'd rather, you know, go in a rapture. Would you rather go in a rapture? Or would you rather die? You know what he said? It really doesn't matter. I said, really? He's in charge of both trips anyway, he said. He's in charge of both trips. Whether you die and you're buried, or whether you come, you're changed in a moment and a twinkling of an eye, God is in charge of both trips. So you don't have to worry about it. Amen. All right. For Him shall He appear the second time. The second time. First time, He sits at the Father's right hand to make intercessions for us. The second time, He appears. He's going to be at the rapture of the church, correct? Ain't that the next event waiting on us, you Bible readers? The next event is the rapture, the catching up of the church. All right? That's the second. That's what he's talking about here. The second time, he will be without sin. He will be without sin. What that really means is he's done dealt with sin. He's done dealt with, he ain't going to deal with sin no more. He dealt with it on the cross. That's what it means. Without sin. He dealt with it on the cross. And if you ain't saved, if you ain't born again, now get this. You take this home with you. Hypothetically assumed situation, that the rapture would take place today at 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock tonight, if the rapture were to take place, and the Lord would come and get the church out, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? You ain't going to do nothing. You're going to be left here. If you're not a Christian, you'll be left here. And the church will be gone. And then all eternal damnation breaks loose. That will come on the scene, the Antichrist. The Antichrist will come on the scene and promise you this and promise you that. And there were 70 weeks of prophecy in Daniel, in the book of Daniel. 49 of those 49 months, 49 have been fulfilled. There's 1 month left, and it's 7 years. And the Jews will fall in love with the Antichrist. They're waiting for him to come. Wasn't that you sent me that about the Antichrist? Karen sent me about the Antichrist. I watched that. It was interesting. And so it was just a thing that's a video. But it portrayed the Antichrist coming on the scene, and the Jews just totally bought into him. And they will. According to the book of Revelation, they will buy into him. So he's here the second time. The church is raptured, and then the Jews buy into this Antichrist. He makes all kinds of promises, but he breaks the promises in 3.5 years. And the Jews are persecuted and they're scattered all. I don't know where they're scattered everywhere. They're gone everywhere. And they realize they made a mistake. And the great tribulation takes place. And you have never seen tribulation days like that. You better be ready to meet Jesus when he comes for the church. Right? Tribulation. Then, for 3.5 years, then after the 7 years, Christ takes and binds Satan, casts him into the lake, in the bottomless pit, and then for 1,000 years, that will be utopia and perfect tranquility over the whole earth. And then the devil will be let loose, and Christ will destroy him, and there'll be war, and then, therefore, he will cast him into the lake of fire forever, and therefore, we'll have a new heaven and a new earth, and then, see, we are saved. Let me say this. We have been delivered from the penalty of sin. I've been delivered from it, and so have you. I've been delivered from the power of sin, and so have you. But I haven't been yet delivered from the presence of it. But that's the next thing on the agenda. I'm delivered from the penalty of it. There is therefore now no condemnation to them that are Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, who walk after the Spirit. I have no penalty. There's no penalty. And there's no power. He's got no power, I'll tell you. He's like this rattlesnake with no fangs. Yeah. Don't say tongs. No fangs, you see. I mean, a rattlesnake, if he ain't got no fangs, he ain't going to hurt you. The devil's been defanged. He can't bother you. You can rub him on the head all you want to. Now, if he's got fangs, you're in trouble. But the devil has been defanged. He has no power over me. He has no power over you. But boy, I'm looking forward to that day when there'll be no presence of him. And he will be gone forever and ever and ever. And we'll be free, free to express ourselves in a glorified state, far better than what we've got now. Second time without sin, unto what? Salvation means deliverance. He's already dealt with sin. He ain't going to deal with it again. He did it right the first time. Next time will be salvation deliverance when it comes through the rapture of the church. And if you happen to be left in the tribulation period and you are left, you know how you get saved? You die for it. You have to, the mark of the beast. If you don't take the mark of the beast, you can't buy, you can't sell, you can't do anything. So, I believe it'd be better to get saved before the Lord comes, don't you? A lot better to get saved now while the church age. This is a church age. Church age ends at the rapture. And then that 1 7 years will take place when God deals with the Jews again. God just put them on hold. Got them on hold right now. But that's what's going to happen. The appearance of Christ the second time during the rapture of the church. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and to them that look for him the second time shall it be the second time without sin unto salvation. Now let me get, I put these words on. Now let me give them to you right quick. So in this way, offered to bring or present, bear to carry, illustration of the scapegoat, goat, many number of people, Matthew 22:14, many are called but few are chosen. And in addition to, that's another word, look to see with your eye. These are all word studies that I do. I love word studies. And then it says this, appear to show up. He's going to do that without sin. He's already dealt with sin. I just talked about that. Means until we have been delivered from the penalty of sin, power of sin, and soon we'll be delivered from the present sin. I'm just showing you the conclusion. The conclusion is 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. That's where the rapture of the church. 1 Corinthians 15:35-50. That's also the rapture of the church. And so now, what are you going to do about it? You heard the truth. You heard the date with death. What are you going to do with it, about it? Are you going to do anything about it? If you're not saved, are you going to do anything about it? I always say most of us have. Maybe all of us have. I don't know your heart. I don't know. But I'll tell you one thing. You must be born again. Amen. I know that. And I know that's the word of God. You must be born again. So, he's going to appear. He's going to come. Be ready to meet him. Amen. I encourage you to make the greatest decision you'll ever make in your life. Accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. All right. I'll ask Earl to come. We're going to stand and we're going to sing and we're going to make decisions. You're going to make a decision this morning. I'm going to make a decision. I made a decision that I was going to worship the Lord, and I did. And I believe you did. I believe we all. We really worship the Lord this morning through the Word. So we'll see what God has to say for us next Sunday. I don't have a clue right now. We'll just wait and see. But God knows. Father, I love you. I love you with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my strength. And I know that you love me. And I pray you forgive me, God, of all my faults and failures. And I hope I pleased you this morning. I hope I did. I hope I pleased everybody in here. I really do. I want to please people, but God, it's important that I do it with the Word. And I thank you for our people, God. They love you. They love the Word of God. They do. They love the Word of God here. And Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would touch our hearts. If there's anyone here, God, that's not a Christian, I pray right now, this moment, this day, that they would come and say, hey, preacher, I want to be a Christian. I want to ask Christ to come into my heart. I want to be saved. Oh, Holy Spirit, call them. Invite somebody in. I know they have to be invited. You have to be invited. And Holy Spirit, invite them into your kingdom. And they'll know it's you. When the Holy Spirit speaks, they'll know. They'll know. And may they respond in the affirmative. Yes, Lord, yes. Yes, Lord, yes. To your will and to your way. I pray they pray that prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
321. Prepare to meet thy God. 321.
trusting statements. When we're all going to stand before God. I want to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. I want to hear that, don't you? I want to hear that. That's what I'm longing to hear. Well done. I want him to look at me and say, well done, Charles. And by the way, I'll still be Charles. You say, what are you talking about? What's Abraham's name? Where's Abraham at? What's Moses' name? Where's Moses at? Okay. I'll still be that. You're going to have your name. I mean, if Moses is Moses and Elijah is Elijah and Abraham's Abraham, I'm going to be Charles. Right? You're going to be your name. Okay. We say, well, a lot of Charles up there. Well, I hope they are. But you won't lose your identity because we'll sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. See? So you know, there's a lot of things we don't know, but Moses was been dead for 1,500 years, and he showed up on the Mountain of Transfiguration. He's still Moses, been in heaven for 1,500 years. So, you know, anyway, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And then, here's the contrast. Lord, we did this. Lord, we did that. And the Lord says, depart from me. I never knew you. Boy, what a sad day that'll be when a person that thinks all the time they were all right, that they had been saved, and all the time they'd never been saved. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. We've done this, we've done this, we've done all these things that you said to do, and yet you said, depart from me. Wow, that is really alarming, isn't it? But thank God. Welcome home, my child. All right, Wednesday night, 6:30, we'll worship here and through Bible study and the children at 6:30, 1 through 6, grade 1 through 6, be there downstairs. So God bless you. Thank you for coming. Hope you enjoyed the word. It wasn't my words or my words. They were God's words. And so I hope you enjoyed those and challenged you. We ought to always be challenged. I'm challenged every time I read this book. It challenges me. There's a date with death, and I'm going to have it. And someday, rapture don't come, but it's all right. God bless you. All hearts and minds clear. Okay. Brother John, would you dismiss us?